Starting from the classical model, actually we went further and we discuss how much energy, how much power is transferred from an external signal into the system, into the atomic system. You remember that? And with very simple classical argument, we found an expression for the rate of transfer of energy into the system in terms actually of the imaginary part of the susceptibility. You remember that? So it's proportional to the intensity of the field incident inside the system and the susceptibility here and the frequency omega. And if you replace chi prime prime here, this is the full expression that we found. Okay, here there is a dependence with omega that we can at the end ignore, but mostly what you see is the dependence on different elements here and the dependence here on delta L. Okay, so if you want to transfer energy into the system, it will be transferred in terms of delta N. Delta N is the difference of population between level 1 and level 2. Okay, and you remember we argued that to transfer this energy, the best way to do it is to transfer the atoms from one level to the other level. Okay, that's the best way to change delta N, is to change the distribution of atoms in with respect to the two levels of the system. Okay, and this allowed us to make a connection with the quantum mechanics approach in terms of probability of stimulated transition, W12 for the upward transition and W21 for the downward transition. So just by writing delta N is N1 minus N2. Okay, we have this term in the front. So N1 is here, N2 is here, and we can write it here in terms of quanta of energy, of optical energy transfer from level 1 to level 2 and from level 2 to level 1. Okay, so this equation is really the quantum expression for the transfer of energy, and this is directly related to this expression. So that's with this, by analogy here, we just get the expression for the probability transition, if you remember. So we get W12 and W21, which are equal because the process is the same, upward or downward, is equal to the full expression that you have here, okay, which is, so it's proportional to the intensity of the incident field coming into the, entering the system. It's inversely proportional to the line width of the transition, it's proportional to the decay rate of the transition, and it's proportional to the cube of the wavelength at the transition on the A, okay? And this is the dependence with omega if we want to consider that. So actually we have directly the expression for the probability transition by analogy between the quantum definition and the classical definition of the transfer of energy, okay? So that's a reminder of last week. Small reminder here in case of degeneracy of level, if you have many transitions coming from the same levels, let's say G1 level at level 1 and G2 degenerated levels at level 2, so you write actually instead of W12 equal W21, you write it like that. G1 W12 is equal to G2 W21, and you recover exactly the same results. Okay. So that's for this part. So now that we know how we can transfer the energy from an external field into the atomic system, thanks to this probability transition here. So now we can write the rate equation. I just want to mention that, which we did not discuss last time. This is a graph from the Sigman book. So you have here a two-level atom, level 1, level 2 here, at some given temperature, N1 and N2, the number of atoms at each level. So this is what we discussed. What happens if you have an external signal applied to the system? You have a transfer of energy via the probability transition, stimulated transition, W12, W21, up and down, okay? So you have this exchange of energy. But this is general. You can generalize this concept, and you can think of the atom also interacting not only with an external field, which is some kind of artificial interaction, but there is a natural interaction with the electromagnetic surrounding of the medium. Okay, anything which radiates around our atomic system here. BBR is black body radiation. Okay, anything that radiates will have also this type of exchange here. Okay, and actually, what we keep, the only information that we keep in this exchange is gamma radiative, okay, which is the decay rate from the atomic system into the surrounding, the radiative decay rate into the surrounding. That's what we learned before, but actually you can describe in the same way as we described it here, just to give you the idea. And you can also consider the non-radiative surrounding of the atomic structure, like vibration around the system. And you can also describe this exchange in the same way as we did it here. And mainly what we keep here, the term that is dominant, is really the non-radiative decay rate, gamma NR, which describes how the atom decay into the surrounding, give back the energy into the surrounding non-radiative surrounding. So this is a nice picture which is discussed in the Sigman book. You can look at that. I just don't want to go into detail, but just to give you the taste of it. Okay, so now we went after that to the two-level rate equation. So we have a system, level 1, level 2, population N1 on 1, N2 on 2, and we have this exchange of energy between the two. We wrote the rate equation here for N1 and N2, okay? And we considered a closed system. You remember, we have a number of atoms. They can be either in level N1 or N2. We are not losing them, okay? It's a conserved system. In that case, you can write that the total number of atoms is N1 plus N2, and this is a constant. And you can write the differential equation not for N1 and N2, but for the population inversion delta N. Okay, and this is what you find. You find two terms. One term which depends on the W12, that means which depends on the intensity of the field that is entering the system. Okay. And here, a term which corresponds to a stand, the relaxation, the decay rate of the system, the relaxation of the system itself. So two terms. One gives you, if you look at only this equation here, you see that the system will relax to delta N equals zero at the end. Okay, so this is at saturation. That means that the maximum you can get when you have a two-level system here, if you pump the system, the maximum you can get is to have N1 equal N2. Maximum you can do is to get as many atoms in the second level as to the first level, okay? There is no way you can get more because you have two identical processes, one going upward, one going downward. So if you have one more up there, it will go down with the second process, okay? So there is a steady state, at least, there is an equilibrium between level N1 and N2. And if you pump hard enough, you saturate the system, and you'll get delta N equals zero. Okay, so keep that in mind. A two-level atom system, there is no way to have inversion of the population. At best, you can have delta N equals zero. Okay, it's clear for everyone? Okay, and if you ignore this term, if you don't apply any field that you look at this term, it's just the decay rate of the population inversion back to an initial value delta N zero, okay? So there is a competition between these two effects, okay? So the best you can do if you ignore this term is to get delta N equals zero. Otherwise, you'll go even to lower value, going down to delta N zero, okay?
So that's very important to understand.
And we discuss saturation of the population. So either you look at the population difference delta n, and you look at the saturation. We know that we will see that either the attenuation coefficient or the gain coefficient are proportional to delta n, so they will have the same form, which is a constant term times 1 over 1 plus intensity of the incident wave over saturation value of the intensity. Okay, and if you plot this coefficient, either attenuation or gain coefficient, as a function of the signal strength, the intensity here, I, what you see is at low value, you get alpha zero, and when you increase the value of your pump, of the field that couple into the system, you go to zero, down to zero. This is saturation. As you populate the second level, okay, you put the atoms from level one, you bring them to level two, until you reach delta n equals zero. Okay, then there is no more atom that can go up. Okay, so all the light will go through without being absorbed. Okay, so there is no anymore stimulated absorption of the light. There is a dynamic, but in the steady state regime, there is no more absorption of the incident light. So the light goes through. The system is transparent. It's not absorbing anymore. Alpha is zero. Okay, or if it's gain, okay, the system is not amplifying anymore the light incoming into the system. Okay. You know the difference between attenuation coefficient or gain coefficient is just a sign. Okay, if it's minus, it will be absorption. If it's plus, it will be gain. But we'll see that in more detail. Okay, so fundamental mechanism in a laser. The steady state oscillation, so the system starts to oscillate, okay? So you excite your system, you start to have photon inside your system that oscillates, okay? So that can be amplified. If we consider gain coefficient here, it will be amplified, okay? You think that will be amplified until there is enough energy. So this value is increasing in your laser until you reach the saturated gain. Okay, you saturate the gain, and if you want to have lasing, you need to have that. You need the saturated gain to be equal to the cavity loss of your system. You need to compensate the losses of your system by the gain, and this is the gain that is reached at saturation. Okay, so gain saturation determines the laser output of your system. That gives you how much light you get out of your laser in such a system. So think about that. In a laser, when you have lasing, you are always in the saturation regime. You saturate the gain. Okay, that means that you have an equilibrium between the two levels of your system. Okay, and this saturated and the light which is produced is the output power of your laser. Okay, any question? Okay. So we discussed last time also the transient, how it goes as function of time, all that. I just want to remind you the concept of homogeneous and inhomogeneous broadening in this context of saturation. So now you know what is homogeneous and inhomogeneous broadening. Okay, it's clear for everyone? It has to be clear. Okay, homogeneous, remember, all the atoms, they have the same characteristics. Okay, they have the same oscillation frequency, omega A. They have the same decay, they have all the same properties. Okay, so they just respond all together in the same manner when there is an excitation and outside excitation of the system. Inhomogeneous broadening is when different atoms have different characteristics, for instance, different omega A, okay, and we discuss Doppler broadening, if you remember. So you are in the gas and you have the atoms in the broadening motion, so they don't see each other with the same velocity, so the same omega A, okay. And for this reason, the broadening of the line shape here is due mainly to this inhomogeneous broadening effect, okay, that we discussed last time. So this is very clear. Either all the atoms, they have the same characteristics and they all respond the same way, or you have to consider them by small packet, okay? The ones that are close to a given value will react in a way which is different from another group which is close to another value of omega A, for instance, okay? So that's what happened here. If you look at this diagram here, we talked just before about saturation of the gain, okay? So I pump the system and I increase the pump, so I go on this graph that goes down like that, okay? And I saturate the gain. What happens if it's a homogeneous rodent system, an homogeneous collection, a collection of atoms which are homogeneously broadened? Okay, so what happens is that they all react the same way. So you pump the system at a particular wavelength, okay? You will saturate the gain, but the same way for all the atoms inside the system, okay? Because they all have the same oscillation frequency, resonant frequency omega A, and the same characteristics. So what you'll see is that actually the gain will saturate. It will go from this blue line down to this line here. So this is a function of frequency here. This is frequency. So the graph that I showed you, this decay that I showed you before, this occurs actually for all frequencies, okay, and in the same way with the same ratio actually, as a function of frequency. So that's the case where you have homogeneous broadening. Now, what happens if you have inhomogeneous broadening? So if you look here, what happened here exactly?
There's a saturation only in the frequency that...
Frequency that are what? That are close to the excitation. You excite your system at a given frequency, nu s, for instance, okay? That's the signal that you sent inside your system, okay? All the atoms that will have, remember the expression, there is this dependence on omega minus omega A, which is the Lorentzian dependence, okay? So all the atoms that will be close in resonant frequency to the signal itself, so the frequency of the signal, they will be saturated by the signal. So if the signal is increased, okay, it will progressively saturate the gain, but only for this group of atoms. So what you see is that the atoms that have a very different frequency, they will not be affected. But when you get close to the frequency of the signal, you see this saturation of the gain. Okay. So you see it's like a hole in the gain curve. This is called the frequency hole burning. You are burning a hole in the gain. Okay. This is saturation, but it's a saturation of a very small region of the spectrum. In contrast to what you see here, where all the spectrum is reduced due to saturation, okay?
So the gain is the distance between the blue one and the red one?
What?
The gain is the distance between the blue one
and
the red
one? No, the gain is the curve that you see here, okay? But this gain changes when you pump the system, okay, when you have the incident field coming inside the system. If the incident field is strong enough, it will excite part of the atoms, okay, so there is no more room, there is less room for light to be amplified, okay, so you go from this gain curve to this curve here, okay. The photon coming after that, they will not see as much gain as they should, they had in the beginning, okay? You see, you have your two levels. At the beginning, everyone is here, so they will be absorbed, they will be absorbed stimulated absorption, stimulated transition, okay? Once you have most of them in the upper level, you will... this is the picture for absorption, okay? What is the picture for gain? The gain is different, okay? The gain is the case where you have a photon coming, and you have a stimulated emission. One photon will give two photons by bringing one atom from the higher level to the lower level, okay? So this is gain. Okay, so what happens if you have high intensity? All the atoms in the higher level, they will go down, they will be eaten by the incident signal, okay? And the photon coming after that, they will not see as many atoms, excited atoms, as they were at the beginning. There are less atoms, so the gain is reduced. And this is what you see. The gain actually is reduced, but it's globally reduced for the case of homogeneous.
It's because they don't have enough time to go back to the higher level.
You have a constant intensity, okay? The higher the intensity inside the system, okay, the less gain you have inside the system. Because this light is eating the gain, it's taking the gain from the excited atoms, okay? So you lose actually the efficiency of your system. So even if you pump your system, okay, we'll see that 2-level atom is not good, but if you think about 3-level atom where you have the excited level, which has a larger population than the lower level, okay? When you have population inversion, okay? This inversion will be reduced by the fact that you have light coming inside the system, and especially if you have lasing. At lasing, actually, you reach a point where all the energy available is taken by the light, okay? So what does it mean? It means that if you want to amplify more your system, there is no atom left, okay? If you want to reduce the intensity, then it will re-increase the population of the excited level. Okay, so there is an equilibrium where there is a kind of a spontaneous equilibrium that's set up in the system when you are at saturation. Okay, if you bring more photon, they won't be amplified because you don't have anything left to be amplified. If you bring less photon, okay, you will get more population inversion. Again, you will have lasing. So if you look in the time domain, and that's steady state, this is constant. Okay, so any oscillation will relax to the steady state regime. You remember the first experiment we did with the sound?
Yeah.
And I told you, someone said that what we find is that it's not amplified crazy at infinity. Okay, somehow it stops somewhere. Okay, it is increased. It's a very nasty noise, okay, but it stops. The level of this noise was saturated, okay, because it reaches some kind of steady state, okay. So it can go high and down and high and down, but it will find an equilibrium. Yes?
I have a question about the second part.
Yeah?
Of the,
okay.
You know, what Jamie is wondering. First of all, the frequency that is showed, is it the frequency that I bring into the system?
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
But if I'm using incoherent light or something like that, just light from a lamp, then it has many different...
Yeah, it will cover all the spectrum, so you will saturate all the gain spectrum.
So I can saturate a few...
Yeah, you can saturate. So I, what is interesting, so just... To think about the future classes, when you think about the laser cavity now, okay? So a laser cavity will lase on spontaneous emission, okay? And it will select different modes which correspond to the mode of the cavity. We discussed that in the first class, okay? So actually you may have several modes selected that would be exactly in phase to be amplified inside the cavity, okay? So you may have actually several holes burn inside the gain curve corresponding to each of the modes, okay? But what is nice is that, so I anticipate, okay, on the future class, what is nice is that in that case, you may have several lines lasing, so you may have a multimode laser, because each line is saturated independently, okay? But in that case here, if I have one line which is saturated, okay, it will saturate all the gain, okay? So there is no room for a second line. There is no room for a second mode to lase inside the cavity. So in that case, a system like that will be a single mode laser. There is no way to have multi-mode lasing in such a laser.
So this system is better?
It's not better, it depends what you want to do. If you want to have a single mode laser, which is always often the case, okay, this is good. If you want to have, let's say, many modes and more energy inside the system, this is better. This shows you how important is this concept of homogeneous and inhomogeneous. You get two completely different type of saturation and two completely different type of lasing at the end of the day, okay? So I hope you really understand that. I mean, people really, they use this concept, they don't really understand that. The concept is really simple if you consider all these atoms as dipoles. And you say here they all have the same characteristics. Here, for some reason, they have different resonance frequency, and that makes the difference between the two. Okay, and you remember this is a Lorentzian. Here you get the Lorentzian shape. Here you get more like a Gaussian shape, and in between there is mixture. Yes, question. Many question. First.
So if I have several frequencies that inhomogeneous bonding, I'll get something that looks like the homogeneous bonding. It's gonna saturate for every delta function. No?
So you'll get many holes. So if it depends really on the homogeneous line width within the inhomogeneous line width. Okay. You remember, this is a sum of homogeneous line width that don't talk to each other, okay? So depending on this width here, and depending on the distance between your mode, you'll have a spectrum with many holes like that. Now, if this is broad, this is broader, okay, then you may completely saturate the full picture here. Yes?
Does the inhomogeneous broadening correspond to the medium in which you have a nonlinear susceptibility?
No, we only discuss linear susceptibility. That means that the polarization is chi times E times the field. So it's a linear relation, okay? We have a linear relation between the incident field and the polarization of the system. There is no nonlinear effect here. Just consider the fact that many atoms with different, different assumption, resonant frequency, okay, they will not respond in the same way to the exciting field, okay? Some will be very close to the frequency of the field, so they will respond to that, they will catch the energy from this field, the other atom, they will not, okay? And so there is no non-linear process here, it's completely linear, okay? Now, why it is inhomogeneous, so that's another story, and the main mechanism that we explained last time is Doppler modeling, okay, the fact that there are different speeds or different frequencies due to the Doppler effect, okay? But we really stay completely linear here. A non-linear system will be a system where P, the polarization, is chi times E plus chi 2 times E squared plus chi 3 times E to the power of 3, etc. Okay, so you have higher order of interaction between the field and the system. Okay. That's okay until now. Yeah. I try really to give you really the physics behind that, and it's not like just equation or formulas. It's really to understand what is a laser and why different lasers have different properties, and all comes from this story. And I tell you, really, people, they don't realize really what means homogeneous and inhomogeneous. They use it, and you have cases where it's very difficult to know if the system is homogeneously broadened or inhomogeneously broadened, especially in the case of semiconductors or laser diodes. Okay, you may have different cases for different type of diode of semiconductors. Recently, we had the question for a dye laser. Okay, dye laser usually is in this case. Okay, now if you put the dye in some kind of matrix like plastic, polymer, glass, or whatever, okay, does it change the property of the molecules? And are we going from this case to that case? And people, they don't know. They just don't know. And it's very important because you want to know if you can be multi-mode or single-mode lasing system, so it makes a difference. But later I will explain to you how we can have multi-mode lasing even in that case, okay? Think about that. Even in the case where you are homogeneously broadened, how can you have multi-mode laser, many peaks? But we'll come back to that, okay? So the next chapter is actually the following of this one. I call that next chapter because I want to follow the titles of the Sigman books for you to know where we are in the book. But it's just the following. So we studied the two-level atom. Then we can go to system. So we want to find a system that can provide with population inversion. Okay. So when you have two levels like that, and you pump your system at an energy which is exactly the difference between these two levels, so for sure you'll have the problem that the light can stimulate absorption, okay, so excite atoms to the upper level, but because it's the same frequency, the atom can be also stimulated to emit light, okay, so there is a balance between the two levels, and you never reach population inversion. The better you can do is delta n equals zero. N1 equal N2, okay? So what would be a good way, what would be a turnaround to find a system where you have your transition between level 1 and level 2, okay? A transition where you have population inversion. You want to have many more atoms in this level than in that level, okay? And if you have population inversion, then you have amplification, okay? So any idea of how to do that? You see, all the problem is the fact that you are pumping at the same frequency as the frequency of the transition. Okay, because any the photon that come in, they can stimulate a transition or stimulate emission exactly where you want to have emission. Okay, so that's the problem. So if you can pump the system at a different frequency, okay, and the pump, the excitation is on one side, okay, and the transition is on the other side. It's somehow independent, one from the other. Okay, then you can consider emission between your transition at some wavelength, some frequency, and the pump at a different frequency. Okay, and then you have to consider not only two levels, but you have to consider like three or four level atom. Okay, so that's what I want to discuss today. And I want to give you two examples. One example for the four-level atomic system. So you'll see that this is really a big simplification. The atomic structure of this system is much more complicated than just four levels. Okay, but it's a good example which is close to this concept. So this is what we call the YAG laser. Usually, people call that YAG laser. Actually, it's ND-YAG because YAG is not really the part that lases. So what is YAG? YAG is yttrium aluminium garnet. YAG, okay, aluminium, yttrium aluminium garnet. And the ND here is the neodymium ions, ND3+. So you have a crystal, okay, which is a silicate mineral called garnet. I looked for what was the meaning of garnet. Actually, I don't know why there is like an inversion in the letters, but it comes from granite, pomegranate. You know what is pomegranate? Rhymonium. Okay. So if you look at a crystal like that, you see it looks like a grain of a rhymon, of a pomegranate. Yes. So this in French is called grenat. Or in Latin, grana, which is really the grain that you have in the pomegranate. And I don't know why in English it is, they reverse the letter somehow. They lost something in the story. But this is what it is, okay? So it's a crystal, it's a silicate mineral, okay? Which is actually why 3AL5O12, And what, so this is really like a matrix, okay? This is completely a passive element, which is going to hold the active atoms, which are the neodymium atoms, okay? And to do that, actually, you replace a very small number of yttrium atoms by the neodymium atoms. 1% is enough, so it's a very low concentration. So you have a typical crystal here, you see, which is actually mostly the silicate mineral with 1% of atom of neodymium inside the system. Okay. And so you have a view of the inside of the gain of the laser. This is the gain medium. I mean the central part of the laser. This is put between two mirrors here. Okay. So what you see here, you have the NDAG rod here. It's a rod. It's a bar. Okay. A small one. You see compared to 1 euro here. Next to it here, you have a flash lamp. You see the flash lamp? It's like a neon of the ceiling here. So this flash lamp emits a broadband light, okay? Energetic light, okay? And this light excites the neodymium atoms from the lower level to the higher level. I will describe the level structure of this type of atoms, okay? You see, just to show you how it is made, actually, this is a broken piece of something which is closed, actually, because you see that the light coming from the flash lamp goes everywhere, so the coupling between how much light you inject into the rod here is very small, okay? So it would be very inefficient to pump a system like that, okay? So the way they do it here is this is enclosed in an elliptic mirror, okay? So this is a mirror, kind of cylindric mirror like that, but the shape of this mirror is an ellipse, okay? And you know that the focus of the focal. You have two foci, yes?
Focal points.
Two focal points, okay? So one is the image of the other. So you put the flash lamp on one focal point, okay, and it will. All the light will converge on the other focal point where you put the YAG rod. Okay, so this way you maximize really the energy sent coupled into the YAG, the NDAG rod. Okay, so this is the skin that you have here. This is the flash lamp. This is the laser rod, and then you have two mirrors on both sides. So people who are doing the lab or will do the lab next semester, you will use this type of gain medium, and you will build actually the YAG laser. So it's very nice, and it's not that easy. It's interesting to see how laser work directly by eye. So yes, question.
How do we know which one of the mirrors is the perfect one, and where is the light comes out? When we look at the system, how do we know where the light comes out from? I mean, there is two sides.
Right. You have two mirrors here, okay? Mm-hmm. But it depends on the reflectivity of the mirrors. Usually you have one which is 99.9% reflectivity, and the other one is 60%, 70%, okay? So the light will come out through the mirror with the lowest the lowest reflectivity.
In the picture, I mean.
Like in this picture?
Yeah.
No, but there is no mirror, so the light is emitted in that direction too. Okay, we miss the mirror here. There is no mirror here. Okay. Usually the mirrors are outside. So this thing is not big. You'll see if you come to the lab, the student lab, it's a small piece like that. Okay. You have a very high power. A high power supply to excite the flash lamp here. Usually it's a pulse system, so you flash, so it's flashes, okay, so you flash the system, and for each flash you get one pulse from the laser. So if you look at the structure of the laser, you look here at the level structure of the laser, you see it's quite complicated. And this picture is already simplified, okay? This is already simplified. So where are the four levels? So actually you have the ground state here. Okay, it's called I-492, okay? You have the first level here, which is actually a cluster of levels. There are not only one level, but there is a number of levels around that energy level, okay? Which is 4I1, I-112, okay? Then you have the, so 0, 1, 2, you have the level 2 here. Usually we count like that. The ground is 0. The level, this level is the lower level of the transition, is called 1. The upper level of the transition is called 2. Okay, so this level, 4F32, okay, which has also a few lines very close to each other. It's not degenerate, but are very close to each other. And you have a number of levels here, which we call level 3. Okay, so we can group them actually. Why? Because you pump the system, so you excite the system with high energy photons, so they go up here, but they are broadband, so they can excite all these levels here. Okay, so we have 0, 1, 2, 3 levels. Okay, you pump at an energy here, which is much larger than the energy of the transition here. Okay? So what happens is that atoms will be excited from the ground level to level 3 here. Okay? And then there is a non-radiative relaxation from those levels to level 2 here. Okay? All these levels, they will relax to that level. In principle, it's a non-radiative relaxation. Okay, so we will populate this level. Okay, then we have a transition from this level to that level with an emission at 1.064 microns. This is the wavelength of emission of the YAG laser, 1.064 micrometer. Okay, and then from this level there is a relaxation. It's not drawn here. There is a relaxation back to level 0. Okay, question.
How does it decay without radiating anything?
So we said that you have two type of process of natural decay. You can have radiative decay by emission of photons, and you can have non-radiative decay by exchange of energy of with the surrounding.
So why
with the crystal itself, with the phonons inside the crystal. Okay.
So why does it emit something between 1 and 2, but it doesn't emit anything between
3 and 2? So that's what. That's the science of the laser. You have to find a structure that's... So we are going to discuss all those decay terms. We are going to discuss that, okay? They are very important. And we are going to see how to optimize it to have a good laser. And all the science here is really to find the good material that will give you the best parameters for laser, okay? So what do we want to have? We want to have a level here which holds the atoms in this excited level, okay, compared to that level, okay? So here, I have a rapid leakage. Any atoms in this level, they will leakage rapidly to level 0 here, okay? So this level will have a low population, N1. And here, if I can hold for a long time, my atoms in that level will have a level N2, which will have a large population. Okay, so this level is fed through the pumping process. Okay, continuously here. Here I hold them, so this is called a metastable state. Metastable is almost stable. Okay, but finally, eventually, it will decay here. So usually the decay time here is very long, much longer, so you have a very long decay time from this level to that level. That means that you stay here for a long time. Okay, and this way you can really achieve population inversion. You can have many more atoms here than here. Okay, so you pump here. Okay, now you don't care about pumping. Okay, this is the exciting field is pumping between these two levels. Okay, so you may have whatever delta n equals 0 between here, we don't care, okay? But the atoms excited here, they will very rapidly decay to level 2 here to populate this level, and this level will decay slowly to that level. And this level will decay fast to that level. Those are the conditions to have a system with inversion population, inverted population. Okay? So you see the trick compared to the two-level system here. We have a pump process, which is at a wavelength, or at an energy level, which is completely different from the transition itself. So the pump does not interact with this transition at all, okay? And for this reason, we can achieve here population inversion what we could not achieve for the two-level atom, because the pump was at the same transition frequency, transition energy, as the lasering transition. Okay? So some facts here. So this is a typical laser. Usually this system needs to be cooled, okay, because it's getting very hot inside the crystal. It's usually a pulse laser, so here are some facts. It was demonstrated in 1964. Usually it is pumped by flash lamps, krypton flash lamps, okay, but nowadays we are switching to laser diode. It's more stable, it lasts much longer than flash lamps, So now we have laser diode pumped YAG laser, and we will go to my lab. I will show you a laser like that. Emission is at 1.064 microns. Usually you can double the emission, so we use non-linear optics. In that case, we use a doubling crystal and a tripling crystal also, if you want to triple the energy. So here you go from 1,064 to 522 nanometer. So this is green, this is infrared. Here you don't see anything, it's infrared. Here you see something, it's green, okay. Usually it's a pulsed laser. It can be also continuous, but most of the time this is a pulsed laser. We'll discuss how to make it Q-switched. Q-switched means using a saturable absorber. You remember the saturable absorber? That is opaque, so which increase the losses inside the cavity when the intensity is low, and suddenly the losses go down because the medium becomes transparent at high intensity, and this is used to reduce the duration of the pulses, so you can reach pulses of the order of a few nanoseconds, so quite short pulses, okay? And the application of YAG laser is used in surgery for the eye, lesion ablation, skin cancer. It is for medical application, but it is also used to engrave, to cut, welding. It is used for optical tweezer, Nobel Prize of this year. Okay, and usually this laser itself is used as the pump laser of another laser. This is what we are doing in the lab. We have a huge laser like that, a YAG laser, which is used to pump a very small laser like that. Okay, so it's quite funny, but this is what the purpose of one of the main purposes in the labs of YAG lasers. Okay, so this is a four level atomic structure. So why four? Why not three levels? Okay, why do we need four levels? So let me switch to the main example. Three-level atomic structure is the Ruby laser. Actually, this was the first laser invented. The first observation of lasing for light was observed by Theodor Mehmann in his system that he shows here. Okay, so this is a Ruby laser. So what do you see here? So again, this is a solid-state laser. Okay, we are using a crystal here. The crystal is called Al203, this is called aluminum, okay. And it is doped with the chromium atoms, Cr3+, very, very low concentration of atoms. Don't put more than that, otherwise it's not going to lace, okay. So this is the crystal that you get, which is called the ruby, okay. It can be synthesized, okay, it doesn't have to be found in the in nature, so it's not, it's really inexpensive, you can really make them. And the laser itself is pumped again by a flash lamp. This time the flash lamp was designed like that. You see, it's like a tube which is how do you say?
Spiral.
Yeah, around the road. Okay, so again to increase the light coupled into the road here. You see here the two electrodes. Sorry, the end of the tube with the two electrodes on the back. Okay, and again, so this is the system here. And again, you need a mirror on this side and a mirror on that side here. The mirror, there is one here. And another one here, okay. And this provides lasing. And this system is a three atomic level structure. So this is the picture of the structure here. So what do we have? We have three levels. So level zero, the ground state, okay, is also the lower level of the transition in that case, okay? So the transition is between this level, let's call it one, zero, ground state, I call it one, this is two, and this is three here, okay? So what do we do here? We pump the system to level three again. We have a rapid non-radiative decay and relaxation to level two here, and then we have emission from level two to level one, to the ground state, okay? So we just keep the last transition here. The emission for the case of the ruby laser is 694.3 nanometer. Okay. So what is better, a three-level atomic structure or four-level atomic structure? What do you think? What would you choose?
Probably four?
Why? Yeah, because this one is earlier. This one was discovered earlier, so we need to get better.
I think we improve with the four-level. That's not a scientific argument. No,
on the four level, you have more time that the two excited levels are constant. So, in this model, the lower excited level is less constant over time.
Right.
What
do you mean? Explain that. What do you mean by less constant over time?
I mean, the whole idea is to create two excited levels.
The whole idea is to have excited levels, but we want to have population inversion, we want to have more atoms here.
You have a level of N2 and N1 for as long as you can.
Right.
But in this model, the lower level has less time, the population is less constant on the lower level, on the lower excited level.
Okay.
You have a better cycling the population with the four level.
Right.
So that's why I think.
In terms of pumping here, to make sure that you get inverse population inversion, how much do you need to pump? At least if you want to have population inversion, you need to pump at least half of the ground level. Okay. Because you want to bring here more atoms here than here. So minimum you have to pump here is half of the atoms in the ground level to go up here and decay here. And probably more than that, okay? So in terms of lasing threshold, okay, how much pumping I need to start to have lasing. It's not lasing. This is just to a population inversion, okay? Already, we need to pump quite hard here to excite half of the system. So it's related to what you say. It's what you say is also correct. Okay, and these things will decay. Here you have a metastable state, okay, so the atoms will stay for a long time here before decaying. Okay, so you need to pump a lot of energy from the ground state up here to succeed in inverting population, okay? In the case of the four-level atom, you know, the ground state is is there. I mean, it's like a bath. I mean, you can take as much as you want. You have photon there. They are not used in the transition. Okay. What counts is that the level one. So the ground state is level one. Let's say okay. That level two, the lower level of the transition, should have a low population. So it should decay rapidly to the ground state. Okay, that's what is important, which you cannot achieve here because the ground state and the lower level of the transition is the same level. You see? Okay, so this is all the genius thing in laser that people really realize that those things. How to get population inversion? This, I mean, it would be very interesting to look at the story of how the laser were invented. This is a very fundamental aspect of the laser. Okay, understanding how you can have population inversion, what type of system can provide with it. Okay, so there is a long story of research behind that, and then people found the right material to do that. So if this one, so I will reverse your remark, okay? If this one is more difficult to get lasing with, okay? So why it was discovered first? We should have started with the 4-level. Okay, this one is much more difficult to get lasing than the 4-level atom, okay? Actually, it turns out that the Ruby laser is extremely efficient atomic structure. It has an efficient energy conversion from standard flash lamp. That means that it takes almost everything from the energy of the flash lamp. So there is a very good conversion from the light. Why is that? Because we have a broad bump absorption band. You see here, this green and blue here in the visible here. It's a very broad absorption band. That means that the light of the flash lamp, which is also broadband, okay, will be absorbed by your system. The level three is very large, okay, so most of the energy will be absorbed, okay, and will be redirected onto this level, okay. So that's the main reason why the Ruby laser is very efficient. Okay, you see an absorption band between 400 and 550 nanometer. So this is very broad, and it will convert a lot of energy from the flash lamp. Another important aspect is that the quantum efficiency, the fluorescent quantum efficiency, is close to one. So we'll define this quantity, but it's clear what it means. It means that the number of photons that fluorescence quantum. Yeah. So it's actually the number of photons that you bring with your pump. How many will be converted into photons that will be emitted by the transition here? Okay, this is the fluorescent quantum efficiency, and if it's close to one, it means that the system is really using all the photons that you bring to him. Okay, all what you give to the laser will be converted into light. Okay, so that's one here, and this in that case it's extremely efficient. The transition is extremely narrow line width. You remember the Lorentzian. If you have a narrow line width, it means that at the center, the gain is very, very strong. So we have a very strong transition, and it is in the visible. The lifetime here, so the transition from the spontaneous transition from this level to that level, you remember it can be radiative or non-radiative. But in that case, it is almost completely a radiative transition. So it's a relative lifetime to one, and it's a very long one, 4.3. So that means that the state is metastable. It lives for a long time. Also, this is the material that is readily available. We use xenon flash lamp in that case. It produces pulses, long pulses of millisecond duration. This is the first laser in 1960, and it is used also in laser medicine for tattoo removal, scar treatment, different things like that. So that's okay. This graph will be the graph at the end of this class, not the end, but at the end of the. After writing out the level rate equation, we'll see that, and we'll compare the efficiency of the four-level system compared to the three-level system. And we'll show actually that if this is the pump here, this is the pumping rate here, you see that to overcome here the losses, this is the laser threshold, you will see that you need a very small amount of pump to get lazy, to overcome the losses in the four-level atom compared to the three-level atom. You need a much higher pump level. Okay? Epsilon 4. I mean, epsilon 4 for me, but this is the title of the chapter in the book, laser pumping, and population inversion. Population inversion, I just simplify. Okay, and I will start first with the four level laser system. So we saw the example of the light just done. So let's simplify the structure, okay? So we have a system, this energy here. We have a system with a ground state. Okay, so usually I want to unify the notation, so I will call this state level zero, okay? We'll have level one here with the, so this is population here, okay? This is N0. We have level 1 here with population N1. We have level 2 here with population N2. We want to have N2 larger than N1. And we have a state here, level 3. Okay. So we have a pumping process. You remember, we pump from the ground state here. We pump like that, from the ground state and to level 3 here. This is the pumping process. So the pumping process will be described by WP, which is the probability transition from level 0 to level 3. So it's actually W03, but it's also W30. Okay, so that's the same description as we did last week, but for the pump here. Okay. We have a non-radiative relaxation for level 3, from level 3 to level 2 here. This is non-radiative. Okay. What else? Level N2 has to be a metastable level. That means that its lifetime is quite long, okay? And we have relaxation, this is a radiative relaxation here with photoemission, which I call, so this transition will be tau 3 to 2, this is tau 2 to 1, okay? And to finish, we have again a non-radiative radiation from 1 0 here, non-radiative, and this will be 2, 1, 0. Okay, this is the decay time, relaxation time for these different levels. Okay, and in purple here is the pump. So some assumption here, so we have a pump WP equal W03, W30, first thing. Okay, second thing, we are going to ignore any pumping effect from the level 0 to 2, okay? We are not interested. We are not interested in this pumping here because it's like a two-level atomic, so we neglect pumping from 0 to 2, okay? We are studying a case where there is no signal at the transition. Okay, the transition is between level 1 and level 2. We are not injecting any signal at that transition, okay? What we're injecting is the pump, and the pump is between level 0 and level 3, okay? At the last part of the class, I will do the calculation with another signal at that transition. You can have that, okay, in the result. But in this first study, let's say that we don't have no signal at transition frequency. Okay. You remember we are going to stay in the limit of the rate equation approximation. You remember what it means? You remember this equation with delta n of t? You're going to assume that delta n is slowly varying with time. Okay, so this is the approximation rate equation approximation. Okay, and the final hypothesis is that we have conservation of the number of atoms here. So that means that we have n equal n0 plus n1 plus n2 plus n3 is conserved, so this is constant. So we don't lose atoms here, okay? And then we can write the equation. So I'm going to speed up a little bit because you know all this story now. So we have for level 3, we have dn3 over dt is equal to what? So we have the pumping process between level 0 and level 3, so it's Wp times n0 of t, okay, this is a function of time, minus n3 of t, okay. And the relaxation between level 3 to level 2 here, so this is minus n3 of t over tau 3 here, okay? What is tau 3 here? Tau 3 is the relaxation time from level 3 to all other levels. It's not necessary to level 2, but it can go to level 1, to level 0, okay? You can relax to any level, so tau 3 is, let's say, 1 over tau 3, to be correct, is gamma 3.0 plus gamma 3.1 plus gamma 3.2. Okay? We know that gamma 3.2 is a very fast process here. So usually this term dominates. Okay, so in general, this is the dominant term here, okay? Because tau 3.2 is very small, very fast decay, so usually this term dominates. But we leave it like that, okay? Then I write dn2 over dt is equal to, so level n2, transition from 1 to 2 and to 2, from 3 to 2, and decay from 2 to 1. So this is n3 of t over tau, this time transition from level 3 to 2, okay, so it's tau 3.2 minus decay from n2 to n1, so it's n2 of t over tau 2. Again, tau 2 here is the relaxation time from going to level 2 to 1 or 2 to 0, okay, you can have both cases. 1 over tau 2 is equal to gamma 2 0 plus gamma 2 1. Okay. And the last equation is, if I can make it a little bit higher. I should have inverse dn3 over dt, sorry, dn1 over dt is what? So you have, you may have transition from level 3 to level 1. So this is n3 of t over tau 3 1. Okay, plus transition from level 2 to 1, so it's n2 of t over tau to 1 minus transition of from level 1 to level 0, so those are atoms that are lost from level 1, minus n1 of t over tau to 1, tau 1 0 and tau 1 is the same thing, okay? There is no other process. Okay, and okay, let's leave it like that. So it's always the same story. You first write the rate equation, then you write the steady state solution. Okay. So I go here to steady state solution. So you make this 0, 0, 0 here for the steady state solution. So that gives you a relation between n0 and n3. And this is a relation between N3 and 2, and here between whatever you want, okay? So it gives you, from the first equation here, you get N3 equal WP tau 3 over 1 plus WP tau 3 times N0. Okay, I should write N3 SS, this state, N0 SS, just to make it light, okay? You understand that we are exploring the steady state solution here. So that's from the first equation. Second equation, N2 is equal to tau 2 over tau 3 2 N3. And the third equation gives you N1 is equal to 2 1 over 2 2 1 plus 2 1 over 2 3 2 over 2 3 1 2 2 and 2. Okay? I encourage you to redo this calculation. I did it before coming here to make sure that everything is correct. So you can do it. Okay, very easy. So we have three relations here between N1, N2, and N3. I didn't write anything about N0 because N0 is related to the other through this relation here. Okay. So I'm going to make to give you two definitions here before the break. Let me just finish that before the break, so it will be good. So I want to define the relaxation time ratio. I put it here, relaxation time ratio. Sorry for my handwriting, it's not very nice. Time ratio. So this is called beta. Beta here in that case is this term here. Okay, we define beta as N1 beta, N1 steady state is equal to N2. Okay, so beta is equal to this big term here. Tau 1 over tau 1 plus tau 3 2 times 2 1 over 2 3, 1, 2, 2, okay. So when do you expect population inversion? Population inversion is achieved when N2 is larger than N1, okay? That means that, I made a mistake here, sorry. No, it's okay, N1 is okay. So N2, no, that's okay, N1. So beta is larger than 1. No, sorry, I made a mistake. I made a mistake compared to here. N1 is beta N2. So N1 is N2 times beta. Now it's correct. Okay, population inversion if N2 is larger than N1 means that beta is less than 1. Okay? Population inversion if beta is less than 1. Okay? You see that if the transition, which one? Yeah, this one for instance here. You see here, this term means transition from level 3 to level 1, okay? If we consider that we have a good laser, that means that most of the energy from level 3, most of the atoms from level 3, they go down to level 2, not level 1 or 0. That means that this term is infinite. Okay, never transit to, from 3 to 1. So I can ignore this term, and beta is about tau 1 over tau 1, and this has to be less than 1, okay? So if this is if 2, 3, 2 goes to infinity, goes to 2, 3, 1, sorry, tau 3, 1 goes to infinity. So if there is no transition from level 3 to 1, everything goes from level 3 to 2, I can simplify beta here just to get the first term here, to 1 over 2 to 1, less than 1. What does it mean? To 1 has to be smaller than 2 to 1. Okay, so to 1 is to 1, 0 here. This transition has to be much faster than this transition. Okay? To get population, this is the condition to get population inversion.
So there is always a population inversion with this condition.
If you have this condition, you have always population inversion. Exactly. Yeah. Population inversion in that condition.
It's population inversion between 2 and 1, yes?
Between 2 and 1, between this level and that level. Okay?
Ah, okay.
So you see, the main condition is that we have a fast decay here, while we have a slow decay here. Makes sense, yes?
Yeah.
It's just logical. Okay, so in that case, we'll have always population inversion under this condition here. Okay. Doesn't mean that we'll have lasing, okay? We'll have population inversion, and we'll have amplification in the system. Then to get lasing, you have to beat the losses of your cavity. It's another story, okay? Give me 5 more minutes, 2 minutes. I want to define the fluorescence quantum efficiency, which I mentioned before. Quantum efficiency. Okay. This is called eta. Eta, the Greek letter, is equal to gamma 3.2 over gamma 3 times gamma radiative over gamma 2. Okay, so you have two terms here. What is gamma radiative over gamma 2? This is the fraction of transition which is radiative compared to all the transition from 2 to any other level. Okay, you want to see what is the fraction of atoms that gives you a photon from this transition 2 to 1, this is gamma radiative, compared to all the atoms that decay from 2 to 1 or to 0. Yeah. Okay, so this is this term here. Fraction of atoms that gives you a purely radiative transition, okay? And this term here, so this is this term here, and this term here, gamma 3 2 over gamma 3, okay? So this is all the atoms that you excite from 0 to 3, okay, they will decay to 3 to 2, to 3 to 1, 3 to 0, okay? So what is the fraction of atoms that will decay from 3 to 2, which are useful for us because they populate 2, compared to all the transitions? Okay, so this is the efficiency. You compare the ratio, you make a ratio between the fraction of atoms that contributes to the emission, okay, gamma radiative over gamma 2, and multiply also by the photons that contributes to the population of level 2 from the pump. Okay, so you want to know how much photons from your pump are useful for lasing. This is exactly what is written here. Those are the useful photons to populate level 2 times the photons that are used from level 2 to give radiation. Okay, so eta gives you the quantum efficiency, the fluorescence quantum efficiency, how many photons in your pump are needed to observe a photon emitted from the transition. Okay? And okay. So I just want to finish that with the calculation of the population inversion, the population inversion, or simply if I want to calculate here out of the three equations, I want to calculate N2 minus N1 over N. N is constant, okay, it's the sum of all of them here. So we have N is equal to N0 plus N1 plus N2 plus N3. So you just have to replace the value here, for instance, as a function of N0. N2 minus N1, you can use this relation between N1 and N2 in your beta, okay? And you can use also this expression eta. So by using that, N1 equal beta N2, and using the expression for eta here, which gives you eta 2 radiative is equal to 2 over 2 3 2 times 2 3. Okay, by using this three relation here, I can replace that here. I encourage you to redo the calculation. And this gives you the final the following result: 1 minus beta times eta times WP times 2 radiative over 1 plus beta plus 2 3 2 over 2 eta WP 2 radiative. Okay, I checked all the indices here to make sure that it's correct. I'm going to reload this class in English because there were some mistakes in the formula. So now it's correct, it's corrected. I'm not sure about the Hebrew version, if it was corrected last year or not. So be careful when you review that.
This seems to be the same.
That's the Hebrew version?
Or the English version.
No, there are some mistakes. There were some mistakes that I found today.
Also in the Hebrew version, there is a mistake.
Yeah, I guess, yeah. So I have to, I don't have the original version to correct it. So I have to find out.
For where the eta came from?
So the eta is defined here.
Okay.
Eta is the fluorescence quantum efficiency, which tells you how many emitted photons you get for one photon of the pump. Okay, so you get a very nice expression here that we can simplify for some in certain limits. For instance, here, 2-2 compared to 2-3-2. If I have a good laser, I should have what? I should have 2-3-2. So 2-3-2 is a relaxation from 3-2 here. Should be much faster than the relaxation from 2-1. Yes, from 2-2 here. So this term here, for a good laser, is close to zero, so I can ignore that term. Okay. If we have a small value of beta, also it's a good laser because we have a strong population inversion. So if I assume beta close to zero and this term close to zero, I have a very simple expression. I have, so for if beta goes to zero and 2-3-2 over 2-2 goes to zero, I will have N2 minus N1 over N, which is about eta WP to radiative over 1 plus eta WP to radiative. Okay, so you see this equation here? So now I have a simple equation for the difference. This minus the population inversion. Remember that the population inversion is N1 minus N2, okay? So N1 minus N2 minus N1 here, normalized by the total number of atoms, is given by this expression. So if I draw it here, that's what I showed you before. So if I put here, this is delta N. This quantity N2 minus N1 N2 minus N1 over N. This is a zero axis, so this is always a positive quantity. Okay. For WP equals zero, we have zero. And in the limit of WP large, this goes to 1. So we have a function which looks like that. Okay. So this is for the 4 level atoms. Okay. This is here WP to radiative. You can put eta. If eta is good, if eta is 1, this will be 1. Okay, so I keep that for the next part, which is the 3-level atomic system. Okay, so we saw the example of the Ruby laser. Can we show that the 3-level atomic system is less efficient, is less good for a laser system than the 4-level? Okay, that's the challenge now. Okay, so now we have a 3-level structure. Let's consider a system like that. So we have energy level here. We have population here. This is N, this is E. We have the ground state, which I call E0. This is N0. We have level 1 here, which we would like to be more populated than level zero is N1, E1, and we have a transient state here. This is N3. Okay, we have a pumping process from the ground state here to this state number 3 here. Okay. We have relaxation time from 3 to 2, 1. Why? We didn't put 3 here. It should be 2, sorry. So this is 2. We don't need 3. And 2. Okay, there is a relaxation here, which we would like to have non-radiative and fast. So this is 2, 2, 1. Okay. We have the radiative radiation here. So this one is the transition we are interested in to have lasing between level 0 and 1. And this is 2, 2, 1, 0, 2, 1. Okay, so this case is simpler in terms of equation. So I start with the rate equation. So I have rate equation. Hello, okay. So for level 2, what do we have? So first, what are the hypotheses that, before I write the equation, what are the hypotheses? We have pumping with probability WP is equal to W02 or W20. Okay? What else? Again, we neglect pumping from 0 to 1. Okay, this is not interesting for us. We don't consider an optical signal, okay? No optical signal at transition. Okay. Again, rate equation approximation. Remember? That means that delta n is slowly varying with time. So in the polarization equation, it can be considered as a constant. And finally, we have conservation of number of atoms, n equal n0 plus n1 plus n2, okay, which is a constant. Okay, so rate equation. Okay, so for level 2, we have dN2 over dt is equal to pumping process WP from level 0 to level 2, N0 of t minus N2 of t minus the decay from level 2 to level 1 minus N2 of t minus tau 2. Okay, if you don't understand why I choose a constant rather than another, you tell me. So T2 here includes relaxation from 2 to 1 and 2 to 0, okay, in principle. And the second equation is dN1 over dt is equal to N2 of t of time over 2 to 1 minus N1 over 2 to 1. Okay? So we have one equation less than before. What is next? What do we do next?
Steady state,
okay. Steady state. So this term equals zero, this one equals to zero, and we get two equations. From the first one, we get N2 is equal to WP2 over 1 plus WP2 times N0. So this one looks like okay. If the pumping is not too strong, okay, if we have a weak if we have a weak pumping, you can ignore this term. So it's N2 is WP tau 2 times N0. Okay, that's to keep in mind in case you need to do some approximation. And the second equation is N1 equal tau 1 over tau 2 1. N2. Okay. So second relation between N1 and N2. So it's funny because it looks like the opposite of here. Here N1 is tau 1 over that's the same. Beta, so it depends on what is beta here. So here I define beta. So be careful here. Beta is equal to N2. So here it was N1 over N2. Here it's N2 over N1, which is equal to T21 okay, so this is for four level, this is for three level, okay. You see the beta, the definition of beta looks strange because this is the inverse of the definition that I gave before, but the reason do you see the reason for that? Again, we want to have beta, we want to have population inversion. Population inversion means what? Means that just 1 second, I have a problem. Yes. So you see here N2, N1. If we want to have population inversion, we want to have this level much more populated than this level, which comes from here. Okay. So what is the difference between these two definitions? You see it's clear actually. The N1, the 1 and the 2 are not the same. In the case of the 4-level atom, the 1 and the 2 where the lower and higher level of the transition, okay? Here, the one and the two, it's not the same. The one is the higher level, and the two is the third level of the level where you pump, okay? So that's the reason why don't compare this definition with that definition, because we are not talking about the same one and two, okay? So it's misleading. It looks like two contradictory definitions. But it's not, okay? So this is just because the numbers are different. Okay, and we define also the fluorescent quantum efficiency. So eta is equal to, in that case, eta will be gamma 2 1 over gamma 2 times gamma radiative over gamma 1. Okay? So it tells you what? It tells you that this is the product of how many photons that are in level 1 here are actually, gives actually a transition. Okay? A radiative transition, sorry. So the number of photons that gives you, the fraction of the photon that gives you of an emitted photon from this transition, times the number of atoms that actually contribute to the population of level 1 here. Okay, so this is gamma 2 1 compared to gamma 2. Okay, gamma 2 is all the relaxation from E2 to the other levels. Only this relaxation contributes to populate level 1. Okay, so if you want to consider the quantum efficiency of your laser, you consider how many photons I brought here really contribute to the photon emitted by the transition. Okay, so this is the product of these two terms here. Okay, so if I use these two terms and I'll calculate again the population difference, so this time it's N1 minus N0 over N. Don't mix up, okay? It's 1 minus 0 here. I spent some time because I made the mistake. I put N2 minus N1. So, and then you are dead because you cannot find a solution. So what you find is a little more complicated, this case. It's 1 minus beta times WP tau radiative minus 1 over 1 plus 2 beta times WP tau radiative plus 1. So you see a slightly different expression here. We have this minus 1. I didn't keep the other relation, but if you have it on your notes, okay. So in the case where beta goes to 0, if beta goes to 0, very small value of beta, so strong population inversion, we'll have N1 minus N0 over N equal to WP tau radiative minus 1 over WP tau radiative plus 1. Okay? So if you want to draw this function on the graph over there, you see that there is a value of the pump here for which we go from negative value to positive value. Okay, you can make this numerator 0 if WP is 1 over tau radiative. Okay, that was your point, okay? In that case, actually, in the three-level atomic here, you need at minimum to get a positive value here. Yes, to get N1 larger than N0, you get to have this larger than 0. So if I draw it here, you start from a negative value, which is minus 1 over this, so it's some negative value here. Okay, and you cross the axis here for this value equal to 1. I think I forgot the eta. I forgot the eta in the expression here. But that's okay. So it goes like that. Actually, if I go from here, see, it will be here. I go like that. Okay? So you remember that's the graph I showed you at the end of the presentation. So let me just fix this problem. I forgot in this expression, I forgot the eta. There is eta here, and here. Okay, and here I just, you can keep it if you want, you can keep it here, eta. Okay, and what you see here, okay, so this is when you have population inversion here. Okay, you achieve population inversion at this value here. Okay, but what happened is that usually you have to be more than just inverted, more than just delta n equals 0. You have some laser threshold here, okay, which correspond to the gain, which beats the losses. Okay, and you see that for the four level atom, this will be the threshold. and for the three-level atom, this will be the threshold. So you see that a three-level atomic structure requires a much higher threshold, so much higher pumping, to reach lasing compared to the four-level atom. And this is because the graphs are slightly different. They are shifted. Actually, this value is one here in this on this scale. And this is three-level atom, three-level atoms. OK? Any question? I want now to reach almost the last point here about gate saturation. So gate saturation, it means that now I have, so I have a system, okay, three or four level atomic structure. Let's consider a four level, okay? A four level, I want to see how I can saturate the gate. So if I want to saturate the gate, I have to inject in the system photons, okay? I have to inject an optical signal inside the system, this time which is at the frequency of the transition, okay? And I increase the intensity of this beam to see how I can saturate the gain inside the system. Okay, so up to now, we discussed the equation without an optical signal at the transition energy. Okay, let's see what happens now. So we have a system, I pump it, I still pump it between 0 and 3. Okay, now I inject a signal between 1 and 2. Okay, at the energy difference between E2 and E1. Okay, so. Let's see. So we have a four-atomic level again, level zero here, and zero, level one, and one, E2, and is it here we have E3. Okay, and now the new thing here, okay, again, we still pump the system from level 0 to level 3 here. Okay, this is the pump. And we include now a signal at this transition here. I need another color. So we have now another signal here, which is W sig signal, okay? Exactly at the transition, okay? So just imagine a laser. You can take a laser and you can inject inside the laser a signal, okay? Or remove the mirrors, okay? Just take the gate media. You inject inside the system a signal at the right frequency of the transition, okay? And you want to see how you can saturate the gate inside the system. We will discuss more in detail in the next chapter. This is an amplifier, actually. You use the system as an amplifier for a signal. Okay, so the pump here provides for the energy inside the system, and the signal that goes inside the system will be amplified, will take the energy out of the system. Okay, so four-level atomic system, pumping WP here, transition from level 1 to 2 here. We include an optical signal at laser transition wavelength, WC. There is no reason that the sum of these two levels is conserved, okay? Only the full system is conserved, so we have that. I want to write it here because it's important. Okay, there is no reason why N1 plus N2 should be conserved. Okay, so this is not conserved. Why? Because you have energy coming from N3 here. You have the signal itself that can take energy from the system or give energy to the system. So N1 plus N2 is not conserved. Okay, and also we assume here that N0 is about N. That means that we pump. We have a weak pumping here. Okay, we have little number of atoms in the excited state. Most of the atoms are in the ground state. Okay, so that means that N3 is much smaller than N0. That means it's a weak pumping. We pump weakly the system. Okay, to excite it. Very few atoms are in the upper level. Okay, so we pump the system, and we write the rate equation. So be careful here. I write the pumping, so rate equation, okay? Rate equations. I start with the equation for the pump, okay? Pumping rate from level 0 to 3. I can write that dN3 over dt, the rate here of variation of N3 due to the pump, only due to the pump, okay? I don't consider the other mechanism. This is what? This is just WP times N0 minus N3, okay? And because of this assumption here, N0, N3 much smaller than N0, this is roughly equal to WP N0, okay? So this is called the pumping rate. Pumping rate. Okay, this is a very important quantity. This is typically the intensity of your pump beam, okay? You have another laser which is used as a pump, okay? The intensity of your pumping laser is given by the pumping rate, WP times N0, okay? What we are interested in is not what is the intensity of the pump. We are interested to know how much of this intensity contributes really to the population of level 2, okay? So I define here the effective pumping rate. Pumping rate. Okay, this is called RP. RP is equal to eta P times WP times N0. Okay, so this definition here is the definition of the effective pumping rate. Okay, so this is the number of photons that actually reach the level 2, okay? So you may pump, and having this pumping rate, not all the atoms will reach level 2, so this is really what we are interested in if we want to calculate the rate equation for level 2, okay? You follow me? Question? It's okay? No? Too fast? You want breaks, so I have to rush now. No, it's okay. I don't want to lose you. So I just define the effective pumping rate, which is really the number of atoms that are actually excited at level 2 because of the pump from level 0 to 3, okay? So there is some kind of efficiency. This is called the pumping efficiency. Which is exactly, actually, this is the same as this fluorescence quantum efficiency, is the same quantity. principle. Okay, so now I can continue to write the rate equation. I will do it for level 2 and level 1. That's the one we are interested in. So dN2 over dt is equal to what I bring from the pump. So somehow I disconnect the pump story thanks to this number. I know that I have RP atoms brought by the pump into level 2. Then I have the signal here. So the signal is taking part of the energy here. So it's W sig minus W sig times N2. That's what we lose by stimulated absorption, okay? And what we gain by stimulated emission down from 2 to 1, and we gain to 2 by stimulated absorption from 1 to 2. Okay, so it's W sig N2 minus N1, I put it like that, okay? Minus the decay rate, spontaneous decay rate, N2 over 2. Everyone agrees with this equation? It's okay? Now, second equation for level 1. dN1 over dt is equal to W signal times N2. I removed the minus, so N2 minus N1. Okay, plus the decay from N2, the spontaneous decay from N2 to N1, this is N2 over 2 to 1. And the decay from 1 to 0 here, so it's N1 minus N1 over 2, 1, 0, or 2, 1, okay? What do we do next? Steady state, okay. I just reproduce the same scheme all the time, okay? So steady state. Okay, so 0, 0 here. You see that you get a system of two linear equations in N1 and N2, right? So you can solve it and you can get N1 and N2 directly. So I will write the solution here. I have N1 equal W, so it's a little bit complicated because there are all these. So I will write it in terms of gamma, okay? So W sig plus gamma 2-1 over W sig times. So we have gamma 1 plus gamma 1 plus gamma 2-0. Plus gamma 1, gamma 2, and everything times Rp. That's N1, and N2 is given by W signal plus gamma 1 over the same denominator, W sig times gamma 1 plus gamma 2-0 plus gamma 1, gamma 2, times Rp. Okay, so the same expression except this term here and that term here. Okay? So if I calculate now delta n, if I calculate delta n, I get the following expression, n2 minus N1 is equal to delta N0, I put some constant here, delta N0 times 1 over 1 plus W signal times 2 effective. Okay, I mean if you just combine N2 minus N1, you get an expression where you can define delta N0, okay, it's a constant term. So this is called the unsaturated population inversion. Okay. And this two effective here, this is called the effective recovery time. Okay, so two typically two effective is roughly tau 2, so I can write it here. So what do we have here? I can give you the constant if you want. It's not very useful, but just to be complete, I have delta n0 is equal to gamma 1 minus gamma 2 1 over gamma 1 gamma 2. Okay. And tau effective is equal to gamma 1 plus gamma 2 0 over gamma 1 gamma 2. Okay, so that's to give you the complex expression. So you see that if we don't have transition from 2 to 0 here, okay, if we ignore gamma 2 0, if this is small compared to gamma 1, okay, gamma 1 is big because gamma 1 is the fast transition here, so gamma 1 is big, so this is roughly 1 over gamma 2, okay. To good approximation, and delta n 0, if you assume that gamma 2 1 here is roughly gamma 2 1, so gamma 2 1 is transition from 2 to 1, okay, is roughly gamma 2 is gamma 2, the full gamma 2 roughly, you get that this term is about 2 minus 2 1. I forgot RP here. For delta n0, there is RP here, okay? So this is 2 1 times P. Why? Because this gamma 2 is about roughly equal to gamma 2 1. Okay, we can assume that gamma 2 is. Okay, so this, with this simplification, what do you see? You see that you have. So this term is the unsaturated population. So before you have strong intensity inside the system, you have inversion only if 2, 1 is larger than tau 2, if I put it right. No, sorry, because it's n2 minus n1, so it's 2, 2 larger than 2, 1. So to have population inversion, to have population inversion, you need that tau 2 is much larger than tau 1. Okay, so what is tau 2? Tau 2 is the transition from 2 to 1, essentially, okay? This transition must be faster than tau 1 to 0. That we know, okay? We want to have a fast relaxation to 0 here to empty this level and keep this one metastable, okay, so this is the condition here for population inversion. Delta n0 will be positive in that case. Delta n0 is n2 minus n1, okay. That's one thing. And one thing which is interesting here, you see that the saturation intensity, so you see this expression here, you recognize this function, okay? This is the function that goes to zero when I increase the signal. So you see, if I plot it here, it will be a function that go from delta n zero down to zero, okay, as a function of the power wc. Okay, so I have a signal coming inside the system. As I increase the intensity of my signal, I saturate the population inversion. Okay, I take the energy which is stored in this population inversion here. The signal comes in and it takes actually the atoms in the upper level, bring them down to the lower level until you reach delta n equals zero. This is saturation. Okay. So we have like a source. This is the source of this is the amplifier. Actually, you have an amplifier here. When you have population inversion, delta n zero larger than zero. Okay, and the signal that comes in will take this energy from this amplifier until you reach a state where delta n is equal to zero. You saturate the gain, and then you cannot amplify more the signal than that. Okay, so this is the basis of amplifier. It's almost as important as the layer, the laser itself. Okay, amplifiers are very important to increase the amplitude of lasers, and we will discuss that in the next chapter. And I want to finish. Give me 2 minutes, okay? I want to finish here by showing you something interesting. So you see all this description, I tried to bring you to description of only two levels, one and two, okay? I remove the pump is in this RP term, okay? The N0 term is roughly N, okay? So we are like looking only, we are focusing on these two levels, okay? These two levels, they are not conserved. N1 plus N2 is not constant, okay? This is in contrast to the two-level atom. Remember the two-level atom? Has two levels and the sum is constant. Okay, so I want to show you what difference it makes to consider a two-level atom or a four-level atom and looking at these two levels here, not concept. Okay, so remember if you have a closed two-level system. If you remember, we wrote it, I showed at the beginning of the class, we have d of delta n over dt, remember, is equal to minus 2w12 delta n of t minus delta n 0 over 2w12. You remember these two terms? You have the saturation term here, the relaxation term here. That's what you get when you consider closed two-level system. Okay, N1 plus N2 equal to constant. Okay. Now, if I consider an open, I call that an open two-level system. This is the four-level system. An open two-level system. Okay, I give you the final result for it. You get d of delta n over dt. So that's what you calculate from the rate equation. Actually, so open two-level system means what? It means that typically what? Typically, we have a system where we have inversion here, so N2 minus N1 is roughly N2, okay? We have population inversion, and there is no... And because all the atoms, they escape to level zero here, so N1 is about zero, no atom remain. No atom remains in level one because they can escape to level zero. Okay, so if you write things like that, you get the following equation: d delta n over dt is minus w signal times delta n of t minus delta n of t minus delta n 0 over tau 2. You see these two equations, two-level atomic system, four-level atomic system. If I write the steady-state solution, I get here delta n 2 minus n 1 is equal to delta n 0 over 1 plus 2 w 1 2 tau 1 2. And here I get n 2 minus n 1 equal delta n 0 over 1 plus w 1 2 tau 2. You see the difference between the two cases? Just to finish on that. You see the difference?
The factor
2 here, yes? So it's exactly the same expression. Okay, the saturation of the difference of population is the same expression, except that you have a factor 2. Why? Why do you have a factor 2? Because when you have a closed system, you have two levels, it's a closed system, okay? When you take a photon from level 1 and you bring it to level 2, you decrease level 1 and you increase level 2. Okay? So it is twice the fact that you have transition of one atom. One is lost on level 1 and one is gained on level 2. So the difference is double, if you want. N2 minus N1 is double compared to the case where here you gain something here, but you don't, let's say, or maybe this way, you lose a photon here. It's hard to say. For the two cases, I see it. When you pump the system, you excite, you get 1 plus and 1 minus. And in that case, it's not conserved. So you always have 0 here. It's like you always have 0 here. So you increase by plus 1 here. Okay, so your delta n is just increased by plus 1. In the closed case, it's increased by 2. Okay, so this is the case. So these two extreme cases, the case where you have conservation here and the case where you have no more atoms in level 1. Okay, now you can have intermediate situation where you still have some atoms in level 1. This transition is not as fast as we would like. This is called the bottleneck of level 1. Okay, in that case, you have don't have 1, you don't have 2. What do you have?
1 and F.
No, you know, we have these two, the three stars. This will be 2 star. Okay, 2 star means some value between 1 and 2. Okay, so that's the way people introduce this concept here. But it's interesting to compare to be careful to this case: closed system, open system. And I was almost on time. Okay. Question? Tell me honestly, it's clear? I mean, you follow me? I was not too fast today. Tell me yes. You don't say yes, it means no. Wait, so, I mean, honestly, you want me to go slower? It's okay. I try to, from the introduction, I try to introduce almost all the concepts that we need. So after that, so.
Maybe you can bring more pictures, like in the presentation.
All the?
More pictures.
More pictures of what? Of lasers?
Or scans of the states. I mean, it helps in the process.
Say it again, I should bring what? More?
Pictures or scans of the states. I mean, it's helps to see the
eyes. You mean this level like that?
Things like that,
yeah.
It's helps to see the eyes. I know that, but I mean, pictures of the state itself.
You mean the reality, like in a real laser, mm-hmm. like the YAG? Yeah. That's what I call the YAG and mm-hmm. But I don't want to switch all the time between the screen and the.
the ball takes too much time. And so that's what I did in the introduction. So you have worked with the ideas. And anyway, we simplify everything with this scheme here of three or four level atoms. It's more complicated than that. But actually, it works. I mean, the description, the theoretical description works for this system. Even though they are complicated, we can really take into account all the complexity of the system.
What counts as a good quantum efficiency?
What makes a good quantum efficiency? So remember, your robot is elliptic mirror. That's one thing. You want to have all the photons that you bring for your pump. You want them to go into the crystal, pump the system. Okay, so that's first aspect. Okay, but what is summarized here is that you want the transition gamma 2, okay, to be essentially gamma radiative. Okay, so 2 to 1. Can be radiative or non-radiative. Plus, you can have 2 to 0 also. Okay, so you want 2 to 0 to be completely zero. You want to have no non-radiative transition. So this will maximize this term. Okay. And here you want to have all the transition from level 3. Okay, where you pump the level where you pump all the transition 3 to 2, 3 to 1, 3 to 0, as close as possible to 3 to 2. Okay, that means that. You don't want transition from 3 to 1 and 3 to 0. Okay? And this is a matter of atomic physics. You know, you have to look for good atoms that gives you the best parameters for that. So, for instance, for the Ruby laser, I don't know if it was a matter of luck or he was lucky with that or he really looked for the right I have no idea. I don't know really what is behind the story there. But. It turns out that he chose a very efficient type of atom that makes it late, you know, and it was not obvious to reach that.
So how much is good efficiency?
One is what you can dream of.
Can you get one?
You can be close to one. I mean, for the regulator, it's very close. But in general, the laser, they are very bad efficiency, like 0.3, they are not good in that limit here for data. The quantum efficiency is not get that good.
So our everyday lasers are not 0.3 efficiency. Our everyday lasers,
they are very bad efficiency. So actually, you put a lot of energy in the system to get electrical energy. There is a big waste of energy in the system. And it's very important when you want to make a device. In order to make a device, you have, let's say, a laser pointer, okay? You cannot put a big power supply. You want just two batteries, you know, that's maximum you can push there. And you want these batteries to give enough energy for conversion from electric signal to pump and from pump to laser. So you have to work on that. You have to optimize your system to get the best efficiency. That's one thing, that's about efficiency. Then when you have a cavity, you want to reduce the losses in the cavity. Usually a laser diode has a very poor cavity, very bad cavity. There is no mirror to you clip the surface of your semiconductor and that's it. So you have a very poor effectivity. But you have a huge gain inside the system. So you have to you compensate, you have to make trade-off.